decades of exploration of outer space with its infinite horizons and limited access, and the fiery risk of riding two Roman candles to get there, are women who broke into a long-standing all-male culture and blazed a trail for others to follow in their footsteps. With so many popular narratives revealing the achievements of space heroines, it's hard to imagine that there was a time when the cosmos was off limits to women.
The first artificial Earth satellite was today successfully launched in the USSR.
When the Soviets launched Sputnik in 1957, America also entered the space age.
Moscow newspapers were first. Russia had blasted a man-made moon into outer space.
Sputnik was a dramatic wake-up call that threatened America's presumed technological supremacy. President Dwight Eisenhower replaced NACA, the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, with NASA, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, and authorized a program to put a human in space. The race was on.
We have one of the most challenging assignments that has ever been given to modern man.
I first became aware of the space program when I was in graduate school. Everyone was very excited about it. This was all being done for the first time, so everyone was trying to figure out how to do it.
These, ladies and gentlemen, are the nation's Mercury astronauts.
I got on this project because it'd probably be the nearest to heaven I'd ever get, and I wanted to make the most of it.
I would give my left arm to be the first man in space.
All the guys are very smart, good educations, test pilot schools, young, good looking, and they knew it, and they were what you would imagine astronauts would be like.
The Soviets beat the U.S. again in 1961, sending a cosmonaut around the Earth one extraordinary revolutionary time. The pressure was on to get an American into space. Behind the scenes, NACA had been employing women to crunch numbers since the 1930s. Later, this included recruiting African-American women with college degrees to work in segregated pools as human computers. No longer buried in history, their stories told in the best-selling book and hit film, Hidden Figures, the mathematicians of the Mercury program are the ones who finally helped put the first Americans in space.
144 miles per hour, 46.56.
The calculations of Katherine Johnson, who worked at NASA for 33 years, would go on to help land the first humans on the moon in 1969 and win the space race for the United States.
First step foot upon the moon.
But breaking into the astronaut corps for women was impossible.
Do you think you can compete with men?
I'm not competing with the men at all. I think that both men and women will be flying in space.
Jerry Cobb and a group of aspiring female astronauts were invited to go through the same exams as the Mercury men. Despite the fact that the women passed the test with flying colors, the program was abruptly canceled.
At that time, the feeling in our country was that there are jobs women could do and jobs they shouldn't do. And they could fly airplanes as good as men, and they wanted to be in space too. They didn't want to go instead of the men, they just wanted to go also. But they never were approved for flight.
Meanwhile, the Soviets beat the U.S. again when Valentina Tereshkova became the first female to fly in space. Finally, the 1972 Equal Employment Opportunity Act opened the doors for women in workplaces across the country.
That was a turning point. If you were qualified and if the job did not require a man, then women should be considered. And there was no reason that we could say the job of being an astronaut required that you be a man.
And that's the 35 new astronauts.
So we ended up selecting six women for that first class. They were smart, and they all had it. And you got the impression from talking to them that if they wanted to do something, they would get it done.
This group of astronauts included Sally Ride, the first American woman in space, Catherine Sullivan, the first American woman to spacewalk, and Anna Fisher, the first mother to fly in space. It was their tremendous competence that paved the way for more first women, including Eileen Collins, NASA's first female pilot and commander, Mae Jemison, the first African-American woman to fly, Ellen Ochoa, the first Latina, Kalpana Chawla, the first woman of Indian origin, Kate Rubens, the first person to sequence DNA in orbit, and Peggy Whitson, who in 2017 set the record for the most cumulative time in space by any U.S. astronaut.
Do you view yourself as a role model of any kind for young women?
It's not something I think about a lot, but I know that the first female astronauts selected were definitely an inspiration to me. And so I will be a role model.
I think the role model issue is one that makes us all kind of think about things. I did not set out to be a role model. I set out to do a job and to try to be good at it. Women can do whatever they set their minds to do. I think the lesson we've learned is that if they want to do it, they should be given the opportunity.
It is a tribute to these trailblazers that it now seems positively antiquated to think there was a time that women were not allowed in.
I was very honored that NASA chose me to be the first woman. It's time that people realize that women in this country can do any job that they want to do.
If history has taught us anything, and as first females well know, every small step by one is a giant advance for us all.